dangerous words hung in the air. Treason, collusion, conspiracy. Powerful people met in secret corners under cover of darkness, scheming late into the night. Are you with me? Can I trust you? A confrontation was inevitable, a great collision of forces. The people were frightened, but the schemers, the planners, the powerful were drunk with excitement. This scene was not Washington, D.C. in the 21st century, but Jerusalem in the first. And for those of you who imagine that politics has no place in the church, may I introduce you to Jesus. To us, he is friend of sinners, hope for the hopeless, shepherd of lost sheep. But to the ruling powers of Jerusalem, both political and religious, he was a traitor, a rabble-rouser, a threat. Remember, he claimed to be the Son of God. His demonstrated power over all the powers of the world marked him a dangerous man. Both politicians and priests feared and loathed him. But they got even. Remember the slur they wrote under which he was crucified? Jesus, King of the Jews? Their hastily scrawled nameplate was neither a compliment nor a confession. It was mockery. It was sarcasm that dripped down on Jesus even as he died. And with Jesus dead and out of the way, order was restored. The lines of authority were reestablished. The true rulers were seated on their thrones. In matters of the world, the people bowed to Pilate. And in matters of religion, they owed allegiance only to Caiaphas. Jesus, that faux king, crisis averted. But long before that decisive battle on the cross, midway through his ministry, Jesus spoke to his disciples, not about the kingdom in which they lived, about Pilate and Caiaphas. He spoke to them about the kingdom of heaven. But he was not promising a sweet someday aloe for their anxious hearts. He spoke instead of a real kingdom, a real ruler. And he warned of cataclysmic conflict, of the great clash between the powers of the world and the powers of God. The powers of the world were and are significant. Remember Paul's words to the church at Rome, his assessment of the world's powers? Hardship, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, sword, death. But Jesus' powers, the powers of the kingdom of heaven, were they able to rival what it was that the world offered? With images he hoped his disciples could understand, he drew clear lines between the kingdom of the world that oppressed them and the kingdom of heaven toward which they were called. What is that kingdom like? There is no easy adjective, no obvious example. Jesus can only say what it is like. So in the kingdom of heaven, God is a gardener planting seeds, and the kingdom is quietly growing. God is a baker kneading dough, and the kingdom is steadily rising. God is a scavenger digging holes, and the kingdom is about to be revealed. God is a merchant shopping oysters and the kingdom is cracking open. God is a fisher throwing nets and the kingdom is wriggling free. The kingdom of heaven is like all of that growing, rising, revealing, cracking, freeing, and it scared the togas off the rulers of Jesus' world because they knew that it was true. They had seen what he could do and that he could not be stopped. There was no king in heaven or on earth like him. But how do we describe the kingdom of heaven in parables that we might understand? Might I offer another? The kingdom of heaven is like young parents entrusting their only child to the mercy of God. The kingdom of heaven, it looks like Justin and Natalie. It looks like Jacob. It looks like baptism. There are some for whom baptism is an empty ritual, something we do to please our parents, or because there's a space in the baby book that says baptism picture. But we know, Jacob's parents and sponsors and grandparents know the truth that Jacob will quickly and sadly learn. No matter how much his parents love him, no matter how much his sponsors and grandparents pray for him, the world will be for him, as it is for us, a dangerous place. And though he may not face the trouble Paul described to the church in Rome, trouble will come. Some of the trouble in our lives is unavoidable, out of anyone's control, but some of it will require a firm commitment. It will require Jacob to choose one kingdom or another. Will Jacob be a servant of the kingdom of heaven or of the kingdom of the world? When Jacob is harmed, will he forgive or will he fester? When Jacob is tempted, will he withstand or will he waver? When Jacob is mocked, will he turn the other cheek or turn on the other? When Jacob is afraid, will he trust God's strong arms or run to the arms of another? These all seem like small things, momentary impulses. But they are more than that. These decisions about how we live are like yeast. They're like pearls. They're like treasure. They are signs of God at work in Jacob's life. Jacob, who today claims dual citizenship, fully engaged in the world and fully engaged in the kingdom that belongs to God. None of us will face the opposition Jesus faced. We won't even face what the early church did. But we, the gathered disciples of Jesus Christ, also claim dual citizenship, living fully in the world, but in particular and faithful ways. We engage politically robustly. We engage prayerfully. We engage humbly. And we never forget that though hard to spot and harder to live, the kingdom of heaven is already here, rising, growing, burbling to the surface. So what does it look like for us to live in both worlds? The kingdom of the world encourages us to hate our enemies, to speak ill of those with whom we disagree, to plot their downfall and delight when it happens. The kingdom of the world encourages opinion without information, reaction without ramifications, shameful behavior without shame. The kingdom of the world worships power and prestige. It settles disputes with guns. But in the kingdom of heaven, we pray for our enemies and we love those who hate us. In the kingdom of heaven, we seek forgiveness when we have been wrong, and we forgive those who have wronged us. In the kingdom of heaven, we respect those who have authority over us, and we pray for their good. In the kingdom of heaven, we care most for the least. Have you understood all this? Jesus asked his disciples. They didn't. We don't. But the kingdom of heaven is ours today. We already live there, and we see it in a little boy, washed in a little water, when we receive a little bread. And always in the kingdom of heaven, we always live with a song.